Welcome to Ring of Fire. I'm Farron Cousins, and here's what's happening tonight. The Koch brothers are showering colleges with cash to help spread their libertarian economic ideas, but what's really happening is that they're trying to brainwash students. We'll explain what's going on. Progressive voters actually like the idea of democratic socialism, and we'll tell you why Bernie Sanders needs to keep talking about this idea if he wants to win the primaries. And the fourth Republican debate is in the history books. We'll bring you our analysis of this week's debate and tonight's backstory. That's what's coming up. You've just stepped in to the Ring of Fire.
There's been zero warming, none whatsoever.
I'm running for president of the United States.
Congress declares war, not the president. Start with the countries that are burning our flags.
We regret these errors and apologize.
We apologize.
We apologize.
And apologize.
This is good news, people.
The Koch brothers are spending millions of dollars to buy influence at respected universities all over the country. They're trying to force colleges to teach outdated libertarian economic ideas that are all just massive giveaways to corporations. But students are fighting back against the Koch influence, and I have FSU PhD candidate Ralph Wilson with me to tell us about the movement to un-Koch college campuses. So, Ralph, we have the Koch brothers right now. I believe it kind of started with FSU several years ago, where they decided they were going to test a little experiment, put some money into the economics and business departments there, and now this has really ballooned into, you know, they're putting money in colleges all over this country. You were there at FSU. Unfortunately, it seems to be ground zero for the Koch money. So give us a little primer on what exactly they're trying to accomplish.
Well, FSU is definitely top five, and it was one of the first places where the public actually found out kind of what was going on, what were the details of some of these agreements. Luckily, it's where we've also been able to find out the most because of Florida's public records laws. And so what we found, and we keep learning new things, you know, pretty much, every week, every month, the agreement between the Charles Koch Foundation and Florida State University in return for several million dollars and in partnership with other partner donors basically is giving this foundation power over faculty hiring. They were giving hiring, firing power. They're able to create their own curriculum. They're creating extracurricular activities. They created something called the Economics Club, which is it wasn't disclosed that it was created in the Koch agreement. It's just passed off as an undergraduate club. They have a paid reading group for undergraduates. You get paid to read their literature. But some of the most troubling parts were actually how this agreement was put in place. In 2011, this was initially sort of studied by the Faculty Senate. They did a report that was published. Through our research, we actually found that that report was not the original one. We found the original report, and it had been censored drastically. Some of the findings that were included in the original one that were omitted publicly were that that the faculty actually tried to stop the agreement, or they asked to have a vote and whether or not to accept this money. They were told no. They were told that it was a done deal, and the agreement was put in place through threats and intimidation. And I'm quoting directly from the censored Faculty Senate report.
So this was something that it doesn't seem like the students wanted. It doesn't seem like the faculty wanted it at all. This was purely the Koch brothers coming in and muscling their way into the Florida State, I guess, administration, really.
Absolutely. So what we have, I mean, we basically see emails where the then chair of the department, Bruce Benson, who was he took a $105,000 bribe basically to stay the chair and carry out Koch's agreement, is emailing faculty in a very threatening way saying, look, if we don't take this money, you might not be able to teach the course that you want. We might not be able to have this department the way that we want it. And so basically we see the dean and the chair at the time threatening the faculty saying, if you want to teach the way that you want to teach, we have to take this money. But then it turns out that they didn't even really have to convince them that hard because they didn't actually have a choice in the first place.
So what has been the student reaction now that all of this has come out, now that this is public, everybody, that's paying attention really knows what's happening. What is the reaction among the student body there?
Well, it's actually very interesting. So sort of in line with the Center for Public Integrity's reporting, you know, one of the things that they point out is that Koch and their partner donors are very focused on harnessing talent from the university. So they refer to what they call a talent pipeline. And so this actually creates quite a rift, because you have students who are for academic freedom and who are for exposing any kind of undue influence. So several student groups that we're involved with are pushing for that. Understand the problem with the Charles Koch Foundation. You also then on the other side have students who are part of that talent pipeline, who are part of the economics department, who are actively seeking a career path in Koch's, you know, giant liberty machine. And they see this as a very lucrative future. And it is very lucrative. They're being offered, you know, scholarships and travel, go to these conferences and things like that. So they have come out and been very, very protective and very defensive of critiques to the Koch Foundation, to the point where, I mean, they've actively confronted people yelling, you know, some on the verge of tears, you know, tearing down people on the internet and things like that. So there's it's a very polarizing issue on campus, but I would say a lot of the pro-Koch people are actively involved in that programming.
And is that kind of typical of what's happening at some of the other schools where the Kochs are involved, or is this or is your experience only limited to what's happening right there at FSU right now?
You know, what we're seeing at FSU is absolutely just a microcosm, and it's also in a lot of ways typical. I mean, at FSU, not only is the economics club, you know, created by the Koch agreement, but there's at least four other groups that are like funded by, you know, Koch front groups, receiving money. College Libertarians have received money in the past. You have FIRE, the Foundation for Individual Rights in Education. So you have a bunch of student front groups that are on campus. And these groups are national. These are groups that are on campuses all over the country, that are basically, you know, AstroTurf student groups. And so the same thing that we see playing out on the national scale is now taking place on the university.
It's absolutely unbelievable. But unfortunately, look, we're out of time here. But Ralph, keep up the good fight. You and everyone at FSU, this is a big issue. I hope people understand this, because this is essentially libertarian, free market, let big business do whatever the hell they want indoctrination. And it's got to stop. I mean, that's the bottom line. And without people like you out there fighting this, we probably wouldn't even know that it's happening. So thank you for everything that you do. And please keep up the good fight.
Yeah, likewise. Thank you.
Both Republicans and some Democrats are attacking Bernie Sanders for being a Democratic Socialist. But this plan is destined to fail because, believe it or not, most voters actually like the idea of socialism once they find out what it really means. Joining me now to tell us why this is a winning strategy for Bernie is John Nichols, Washington correspondent for The Nation magazine. John, we at Ring of Fire, we've gotten a lot of emails and tweets and everybody saying, you know, Bernie Sanders, we love him, he's great, but as soon as somebody brings up the socialism issue, his campaign is going to be DOA. Well, you know, these people may not be looking at the bigger picture, because as it turns out, a lot of progressive Democrats seem to be on board with the idea of democratic socialism once they understand what this actually means. Is that about right?
I think that's reasonable. Whether they're on board or simply comfortable enough to vote for somebody who identifies as a democratic socialist, we could debate the terminology there. But the fact of the matter is, polling shows that a substantial portion of Democrats, in fact, a majority in many polls, are comfortable with the term democratic socialism, and they're comfortable with the components of that. Now, that does not mean that they're all democratic socialists. It doesn't mean that every young person who says they've got a more favorable view of democratic socialism than capitalism is an active democratic socialist, or that other folks who fall into that category are. What it means is that I think we've seen a generational shift and a societal shift, where the term socialism was once something that Democrats ran from and were afraid of and Republicans used as an epithet. That was certainly the case at one point. I just don't think it's so resonant anymore, especially among younger people.
Well, you know, the term socialism, as you just said, it's had this negative connotation. I mean, that's what we basically saw with communist Russia. The term communist and socialist at the time were essentially interchangeable, you know, by the media mostly, by politicians. And so it got this negative connotation. But Bernie Sanders, by no stretch of the imagination, is a communist. But when you talk to anybody who is not, on the left, they do believe that socialism and communism are interchangeable. They believe they're one and the same. And so, we have to overcome this language issue, I guess. But it's the ideas that he has that resonate so well. And we're seeing reports now he is attracting moderate Republicans. There are groups, Tea Party patriots for Bernie Sanders. And it's not because they've suddenly become socialists. It's because, look, these issues that he is talking about, they're really not partisan. I mean, universal health care, not partisan, free college tuition, that's not partisan issues. And I think his common sense approach towards politics, towards policy, is really what's resonating with voters across the board. Now, whether they want to call it socialism or not, it's resonating with people, isn't it?
I think it is. I mean, if you look at the incredible turnouts at rallies, and if you look, frankly, at the poll numbers, I mean, his poll numbers are still quite strong. They may not be as strong as they were a month ago, and they may be stronger a month from now. And the way to understand it is that Sanders is a credible contender for the presidency of the United States. He is certainly a credible contender for the Democratic nomination. He will debate Hillary Clinton and Martin O'Malley. And frankly, he will continue, I think, to attract a substantial number of supporters. Now, I think one of the things we need to do as we get into this sort of discussion is to first off say that Sanders needs to talk about democratic socialism, not less, but more. He needs to explain it. He needs to tell people how he sees it, how he defines it. And that isn't to say that he's got to go out and be some proselytizer or some, to be professorial about it. But if people are considering him for the presidency of the United States, he has some duty to discuss, what it means, what his ideology is, just as, and I think this is an instructive thought, just as Ronald Reagan back in the mid-1970s had a duty and a responsibility as he contended for the presidency to talk about what his view of a new conservatism, a new right, was. And, the interesting thing is in the mid-1970s, there were plenty of people who said, based on the Goldwater experience, there was just no way that a hardcore, passionate conservative was ever going to be elected president of the United States, that the conservatism of a Ronald Reagan was just too extreme, too far out for the country. Reagan connected his conservatism to historic ideals, to historic principles, to American history, and over a period of time went from losing the Republican nomination to winning it and winning the presidency. Sanders would do well to study that history a little bit. Go out, explain where you're coming from. Now, maybe it'll work, maybe it won't. But the fact is that democratic socialism has deep roots in America. Democratic socialism is the ideology of Helen Keller and Albert Einstein and Norman Thomas, who was a counselor and friend to President Franklin Roosevelt. Roosevelt referred to Norman Thomas as my friend. Roosevelt invited Norman Thomas to the White House to talk about policy and economics. And Norman Thomas was the Socialist Party candidate for president 6 times. And so if we go back in our history, what we realize is that we haven't always been, running screaming from the room when the word socialism was mentioned. In fact, many of our presidents have taken the counsel of democratic socialists, have taken ideas from them, have invited them into the White House. Remember, the guy who came up with the ideas that underpinned the war on poverty that began to be scoped out by the Kennedy administration and certainly was embraced by the Johnson administration, that was a guy named Michael Harrington. He was the founder of Democratic Socialists of America. And Harrington's close ally, A. Philip Randolph, who called the March on Washington in 1963 and met regularly with Presidents Kennedy and Johnson about civil rights and economic issues, was one of the leaders of the Socialist Party.
And so for Bernie Sanders today, these are all great historical, examples. So what he should do is embrace this a little bit more. And when you have people, a couple months ago, we had Claire McCaskill come out and say, why is nobody talking about the fact that he is a socialist? I think it's those attacks that really kind of reinforce the negative stereotype of what socialism truly is, while completely ignoring the last, 100, 150 years of American history. I mean, it was these, democratic socialist ideas that brought us the New Deal, because it's not about making sure everyone has the same amount. It's about making sure that everyone is taken care of. I mean, there's a big difference between, wealth redistribution and a living wage for all workers. And so those are the points that you think Bernie Sanders needs to be hitting on.
Well, I think, look, I did an article for The Nation where I didn't go for what I think he should do. I went and asked the Iowans, because they're going to have to decide this thing. And the fascinating thing was that when I talked to people in Iowa, farmers, factory workers, postal workers, some of whom were actively backing Sanders, some of whom are still sorting it out. And I said, well, what do you think about this democratic socialism thing? I was struck by how very few of them were bothered by it. It wasn't a big deal. But almost all of them said, yeah, he should explain more. He should talk about it. He should let us know what he thinks. And then I said to him, well, what do you folks think? What do you think about it? And so many of them said, well, I drove here on a highway. I guess that's socialism. And, I like to go to the library. I guess a public library is somehow, it's something we do together, public education. I like Social Security, Medicare, Medicaid. And started running down all these things that, whether you want to call them socialism or not, and I'm a little cautious about that. I think we should be careful about, just kind of jumping into saying everything that's public is necessarily a social democratic model. But what these folks pointed out was all of those things have been attacked by some conservative who said, well, Social Security, Medicare, Medicaid, those are dangerous socialist ideas. Well, America loves them. America loves those things. America's pretty happy about the post office. America's pretty happy about the interstate highway system. There's a whole bunch of things that we do publicly, we do together, that America likes. And if the definition of democratic socialism that Bernie Sanders brings forward, and it is the one historically that he's suggested, brings in some element of that talks about it in that way, I don't necessarily think that it's something that's going to scare people. I think it might, frankly, intrigue folks who haven't considered him. But also, intriguingly enough, I think it opens up an honest debate. We've had too narrow a debate in this country for too long, where libertarian ideas and socialist ideas and innovative notions from across the political spectrum are sort of shunted to the side and called too crazy. Well, so-called crazy libertarian ideas, like real full-on gay rights, LGBT rights, where we really do respect the right of people to marry and to be full members of our society. Well, that one's done pretty well. Legalization of marijuana, that was thought of at one time as a pretty crazy libertarian idea. That one's done pretty well. We've got a lot of libertarian ideas that have entered into our mainstream, just as social democratic ideas like Social Security, Medicare, Medicaid, programs like that have. And we need to open the dialogue up. And my sense is that when we do, we're going to find Americans are more than willing to sample from a wide range of ideas, and frankly, to respect and welcome political leaders who are similarly open to a wide range of ideas.
And before we go here, I just have to get your opinion on this. This week, we had the fourth Republican debate.
Yes.
Nothing new. No real standout person who did well. Rand Paul, he got a little bit in there. He got some fight in him. But overall, the debate and the Republican field, I would love to just get your take on that.
Sure. Well, I give Rand Paul high marks. Rand Paul called out the military-industrial complex, in the sense of the massive spending for it, said that we can defend our country, but we don't have to spend at these extreme levels. I would certainly love to hear a Democrat get up and say some of the same things that Rand Paul said. And not on other issues, by the way, but on that one, I was quite impressed with the guy, and I give him credit. I thought the Republican debate, the fourth debate, was deeply disappointing because of the responses of the candidates to questions about the minimum wage. They showed a stark ignorance and a stark sort of misinterpretation of both the present circumstance and the future. I was powerfully struck by Ben Carson's suggestion that every time we raise the minimum wage, we lose jobs. That's just wrong. It's false. The fact of the matter is that Harry Truman almost doubled the minimum wage, And a year later, we'd had a dramatic drop in unemployment. In fact, when we're not in a recessionary period and we raise the minimum wage, we generally have increases in employment. I'm not necessarily saying the minimum wage leads to more employment, but the notion that it's somehow some horrible, horrible barrier to jobs is false. The other thing that I thought was profoundly false and deeply troubling was Marco Rubio's suggestion that we can't raise the minimum wage because if we do, those jobs will be automated. So in Marco Rubio's vision of the future, we must never, ever raise wages because if we do, somebody's going to threaten us with a robot or somebody's going to threaten us with automation. I think robotics and automation are huge issues. We do need to be discussing them politically. But the fact of the matter is, if that's the calculus for the future, then we're never, ever going to raise wages. We're always going to be afraid that we're going to be automated out of a job. That is a backward and really ill-thought vision of the future. And what I would suggest is that we really need to counter the Marco Rubios of this world and say, no, the future can be a place where we do have digital innovation, we do have automation, and we use the benefits of a technological revolution to allow people to work less and get paid more. Why do we have to follow the Marco Rubio model that simply says the only beneficiaries of the future will be CEOs, stockholders, and speculators? He's wrong. And frankly, I was shocked, really shocked, that the moderators didn't follow up on that because, frankly, we shouldn't allow such foolish notions to stand without questioning.
I think that's part of their new debate rules is even if I say something that's wrong, you cannot correct me. But John Nichols, Washington correspondent for The Nation magazine, always a pleasure talking to you. We'll do this again, definitely. And thank you for all your insight on everything today.
Such a pleasure. I really appreciate it.
The Fox business people, they treated these debaters, if you will, these Republican hopefuls with such kid gloves. I mean, they handled these Republican debaters, you know, much in the way that I would handle my 2.5-year-old son. He's not quite ready to go out there in life on his own. So I'm going to help him, you know, and make sure he doesn't fall. And if he falls, I'm going to kiss his boo-boo. There was a lot of that from the Republican moderators. But and as an example, so one question given to Donald Trump. Now, as you know, Farron, the TPP has recently be released, the text from the TPP. It is slated to be voted upon by the House and Senate. If we follow the legislation within 90 days or so, we'll see if that happens. There was a question about the TPP. It was given to Donald Trump. Donald Trump is an opponent of the TPP, in his words, largely because currency manipulation by the Chinese is not addressed in any way. And in this, the debate, one would imagine that you would ask the question about the TPP to three of the people on stage. There's eight people on stage. Would you ask the three people who are actually going to vote on this, right? Because Donald Trump is making a populist case about voting against the TPP. You've got guys like Ted Cruz, who arguably try and say that they're populist. You've got Rand Paul on there, who supposedly wants a free market and doesn't want crony capitalism. But this thing basically is just a huge giveaway to big pharma and big IP, if you will. And you've got Marco Rubio, the supposed front runner, even though he's in third or fourth place in the polling. How is he going to vote on it? They didn't even ask them that question. They just asked Donald Trump. How much of a break do you need to give to these Republican presidential hopefuls, Farron?
You know, what's funny about the whole thing is that they can't go after guys like that because even Fox doesn't necessarily want Donald Trump to win. You know, they need him to stumble. They need Carson to stumble. Fiorina's doing a decent enough job, and Carson, of stumbling on their own. Right. So you ask a guy like Donald Trump about this hugely political policy thing, which is the TPP, and for the question they answered, he gave an answer, although incorrect, that his group of supporters They do like that. So you can't ask a Rubio, one, because he's probably not even going to show up to vote on it. Ted Cruz, I don't know that he can read it. And Rand Paul, it depends on the direction of the wind that day, because you got to have the free market. But at the same time, he's not crazy. So you don't ask those guys because they have something to lose from this. Donald Trump.
They all have something to lose. Look, this is Obama's TPP, right? The Democrats have voted against this. They didn't want to give him, or I should say, they voted against the giving him the fast track authority. By all accounts, you're gonna pass this with a majority of the yes votes are gonna come from the Republicans. I mean, saying to Ted Cruz, how can you let President Obama have this deal that he wants, and making Ted Cruz talk about it, making Marco Rubio talk about it, very dangerous for them politically. Why not, in Fox's mind, why not make this a liability for Donald Trump alone? Let's let our guys avoid this topic. They went on Carly Fiorina and they said, how can you make an argument that the economy is bad when you've seen a lot of private sector job growth? The public job growth has been anemic. In fact, we've lost public jobs over the Obama administration, unlike what we've seen under Republican presidents. But his private job growth has been significantly, astronomically larger than George Bush. It's been significantly larger than preceding Republican presidents. They asked that question of Carly Fiorina, somebody who's not in the mix. Why don't you ask that question of Marco Rubio? Why don't you ask that question of Ted Cruz? Why don't you ask that question of Jeb Bush if you think he's still in it? I mean, they protected on every single question. You could basically parse and figure out who Fox wants to keep into the race, who Fox felt needed a leg up, and they protected those people from the tough questions. And like you said in the last segment, Farron, this may help them in the short run, but in the long run, they're going to be devastated because they're not going to have any response for these things.
When they're debating Hillary Clinton or Bernie Sanders or whoever it is, they're not going to get a question of, out of the two of you, whose tax plan would God support?
Right.
I mean, that was a legitimate question asked during this debate.
You should say a illegitimate question that was actually asked, because people may think you're joking, but no, that was literally the question. And so you're right. It's shocking. The debate, and I should say this because, you know, look, I know a lot of our listeners are going to go home to Thanksgiving. They're going to sit down with their crazy uncle or their crazy aunt or their crazy cousin or their more unfortunately, crazy brother or sister or crazy mom or dad. And their crazy folks and their relatives are going to repeat some of the ridiculousness that we heard during that debate.
And that's all the time we have for tonight, but you can get more Ring of Fire on our website at ringoffireradio.com, and you can subscribe to our daily podcast. Just go online to rofpodcast.com. I'm Farron Cousins, and we'll see you next week.